I am Mr. Taru. Okay, we are starting one of my favorite topics, which is trigonometry. Study of triangles and their rotations around a circle. This is used in engineering, measurements of just real life items that are too big to do with a ruler and a straight edge and, you know, stuff like that. So, has to do a lot as well with mathematics of rotation and spheres. So we live on a globe. Lots of mechanical items have tons of spinning objects in them. Just think of an engine with the spinning crankshaft. So very, very important in later studies of mathematics and engineering. So let's get started with a very basic idea and some definitions. We're going to introduce standard position angles and try to, in probably a two-part video, explain what radian measures are. That's another way of measuring rotation besides degrees. Okay, a standard position angle has a vertex on the origin and its initial side on the positive x-axis. So if I wanted to start drawing a standard position angle, I would start off by putting the vertex on the origin and the initial side on the positive x-axis. Now the terminal side is the only part that's allowed to move in a standard position angle. So let's draw a 45 degree angle. Bam! This is the terminal side. Well, that's fine, but that's an incomplete picture because one of my other definitions I have to talk about is coterminal angles, and those are angles that have a measurement two angles that have measurements that are separated by a full rotation of either 360 degrees or 2 pi radians, which you might not understand what that means yet, but hopefully at the end of this video, you will. Okay, so we have an initial side, a terminal side. Now I need to add an extra part to this diagram to indicate what direction the rotation is and what and how much rotation there is. So I'm going to draw a little arc. That's going to indicate, of course, counterclockwise rotation, and I did say that we were drawing a 45 degree angle. Well, what if I wanted to draw a negative 45 degree angle? What would that negative rotation look like? Well, so I'm going to draw another angle on this exact same picture. Well, all angles in standard position have their vertex on the origin, and they all share the same initial side. So, there, that's the first part of my new angle that I'm drawing. But now I want to rotate negative 45 degrees. Well, positive rotation is counterclockwise from the positive side of the x-axis, the initial side. And so I think you might guess what negative 45 degrees is. That's clockwise rotation, again, from the positive side of the x-axis. So something like that. So there we have an initial and terminal side. We have another initial and terminal side of the negative 45 degree angle. And okay, so there you go. All drawings of standard position angles, vertex in the origin, positive x-axis, rotate counterclockwise for positive rotation and clockwise for negative rotation. Now later on in this textbook, and in your class, you're probably studying some bearing questions. You know how to read a compass? Compass rotations, bearings are going to be based off of due north, so that'll be might be a little bit confusing for some of you when we get to those questions about bearing. But standard position angles, all those rotations do start off of the positive side of the x-axis. This is not just navigation. Okay, now you see I've got 1, 2, 3, and 4 up here. This is just the coordinate plane. This is coordinate 1, coordinate 2, coordinate 3, and coordinate 4. So 45 degrees is in quadrant 1, and negative 45 degrees will be in quadrant 2. Now let's talk about this idea of coterminal angles having measurements separated by full rotation of 360 degrees. I want to draw an angle that is coterminal to 45 degrees. Well, what's that going to look like? Well, it's going to be in standard position, so it's going to share the same initial side, but all standard position angles share the same initial side. All of them have the vertex on the origin. So, you know, this doesn't say co-initial angle. It says Coterminal angle. Cohabitate, coexist, cooperate, work together, share. They are sharing the same terminal side. That's the big deal. That's the side that moves. They all share the initial side in standard position. So an angle that is coterminal to 45 degrees is going to look like, well, a 45 degree angle. But that's not a complete picture. That is that 45, or is that an angle that's coterminal to 45? We don't know that without these little arcs to indicate direction of rotation and how much. I need to rotate an additional full rotation of 360 degrees, and I'm going to show that by doing this. Start on the positive side of the x-axis, rotate positively, because I just decided to do a positive rotation, and I'm going to rotate all the way around until I get back to that same terminal side. And now how many degrees have I graphed here? I've graphed a full 360 degrees plus an additional 45 degrees to make an angle that is 360 plus 45 is 405 degrees. Now we could also rotate in the opposite direction as well. We could also, instead of adding 360 like I've done, subtract 360, and that'll show an angle of rotation instead of going counterclockwise, of going clockwise. But if I do any more arcs in this, you're not going to be able to read anything at all. But we could do 45 minus 360 and get a negative, what would that be, 315 degrees? So you can add or subtract a full rotation and get a coterminal angle. Now I got one more definition up here for you, which is a quadrantal angle. I've drawn an angle in quadrant 1, and I've drawn an angle in quadrant 4 with the negative rotation. If I draw an angle such as, let's say, 90 degrees, well, if I rotate exactly 90 degrees, I'm landing the terminal side on an axis line. I'm not actually in quadrant 2, and I'm not in quadrant 1. I'm exactly in between quadrants 1 and 2. This angle is not in a quadrant. It's a quadrantal angle. Any angle with a measurement of 90 or a multiple of 90 is going to be considered a quadrantal angle, and its terminal side is not going to be in a quadrant at all. Okay. Let's erase all this and get on to the next topic. Which is how to measure rotation with radians and not degrees. We care about another way of measuring rotation because in certain areas of mathematics, when we're doing mathematics where things are spinning a lot, like engineering, if we're doing navigation around a globe, a round sphere, some mathematics can be done easier with radian measures as opposed to degrees. Now let's talk about a full rotation of 360 degrees. Alright, it's not too bad. And we have a radius, so we have a circle, I've rotated 360 degrees, and thus I got a kind of a bottom-heavy circle here. So let's talk about a measure of rotation that we are comfortable with, which is degrees, and see if we can't get that converted into the idea of radians. Now, for radians, I want to talk about this idea of pi. Now, every time you see the letter pi, which stands for approximately 3.14, that automatically does not mean you have a radian measure, but pi of 3.14 does have a lot to do with radians. Do you know where 3.14 comes from? A lot of my students did not. Well, if you take a circle, such as we have here, only maybe yours is actually round, and I'm going to have this length of r, and I'm going to try my best to estimate this length and wrap it around my not-so-perfect circle. So maybe somewhere around, let's say, here. And that is one length of the radius. And so we have one length of that radius. And let's eyeball that as much as we can again, as good as we can, and say it's probably somewhere around there. and lengthen and lay down another length of the radius of the circle. So now we're at two radiuses. And then finally, let's do another length of the radius, which is probably about there. And now we're at three radiuses. And where are we on the circle? We're almost to the other side of the circle. So in a measurement of rotation that we are comfortable with, which is degrees, I have just about gotten to the other side of the circle. I've just about gotten to 180 degrees. Now, I'm counting off the radiuses, and I'm almost at that 180 degrees. What do you think is left in that little bit of a gap? What value do you think is in that little piece right there? Well, that little piece is equal to 0.14 radiuses. So 3.14 is the number of radiuses or radii to get halfway around a circle. So now you could also say that pi, 3.14, is a ratio of the entire circumference with the diameter. 3.14 diameters get you all the way around the circle, but all of our formulas are going to be based off the radius and not the diameter. So I'm going to say, and it is true, that 3.14 is the number of radii to get you halfway around the circle. Well, halfway around the circle is 180 degrees, so 180 degrees is equal to pi radians. Now, where do you think they got this idea, this name of radians, from? Well, because it's measured and based off of the radius sud. So radians is based off of the measure of the radius of the circle. And so radians is found by doing S over R, which is, S stands for arc length, and dividing that by the length of the radius. So regardless of how big the circle is, you know, a circle, there's only one shape that is a perfect circle. So regardless of the shape of that circle, 3.4 or 3.14 radiuses is what it takes to get you halfway around the circle. So pi radians equals 180 degrees. Nice. Okay, you also might note that one radian gets you somewhere near the end of quadrant one. Two radiuses get you into quadrant two, and three radians are still going to be in quadrant two, almost getting you to 180 degrees. I'm getting close to getting out of time, so in the next video, we're going to look at converting from degrees to radians and building up all of the angles around what you'll know eventually, not in this video, but what you'll know eventually as the unit circle, which is hugely important for you to memorize in the rest of your studies for trig. I'm Mr. True. I'll be right back.